Okay. Good afternoon and welcome to the orga meeting. We're very happy with all the people here. According to the list, about 50 people. We're going to do this a bit different than the past few meetings, because one of the complaints was, okay, everyone is presenting and we're not actually doing anything. I'll be presenting something that we've been doing over the past 2 months, opening the ticket shop, something about the budget, etc. And after that, we have our design presentation and something more specific about the parking. And after that, you can collaborate, do things together, work on projects, teams, whatever you think is necessary. And at the end of the afternoon, if you have signed up for it, there's a barbecue from RevSpace. I believe that there's still space, though, for the barbecue. I don't know who you have to contact for that, but if you want to have food, then sign up. So the terrain. Last time, the question was, is the contract already done and everything? Well, it only had to be signed the last time, and well, that's all be done. We got it countersigned back, and we have a terrain, so that's good. So the permit is, our team is working hard on that. That's how it normally works. We got all the forms and we have to fill in a lot of papers. Jeroen van Veen isn't here today. He's coming back from Venezuela. He was on a nice vacation there, I hope. But the idea is that we have a few points over the next few months where we go to the municipality and where we fill everything in together with the scouting. But that's how it normally works, and we don't see any hassle there. With the scouting, we had a meeting last Tuesday at their location, and they have a new director, and we're going to work together on a lot of subjects. For example, the Porto Cabin complex. What we're planning is that it will be there the entire season, and we will use it only during the period that we will be there. That's simply because of the cost. To deliver a Porto Cabin complex is and let it picked up again is more expensive than the time that you're renting it. And for that, we are working together with the scouting because they have scout in 4 weeks after us, so we can split the cost a bit. Same for a few other things like sanitary. There will be toilets for like 2 months, and that's cheaper than just renting it for the period of our event. There will definitely be enough showers and toilets for teardown and build up. So we have a very nice terrain, and Ruud has already made a map that you can actually see if you go to map.sha2017.org. So I hope it doesn't crash while we're demoing it. It might. Oh. Okay, so it doesn't have everything placed, but I'd like to go over it, what is where. And it isn't set in stone yet, but we have had to make a few decisions on what to place where, also for build-up time and how the field looks. Well, on the right side, there's the water with hopefully a large harbor that Brenno is planning. And you will have camping fields here, B3, B2. We have made some estimates on how many people can camp on all the fields. Now we also have, if we go south a bit, B4, and in the north B1. Now the problem is that there won't be any power there. Maybe if you're lucky, or if Timo is willing, then one outlet there, but that's about it. So that will be silence fields.
We have the microgrid
project.
Oh, awesome.
Well, problem solved.
Maybe there will be power there.
Okay. So if we then go through the north, we have K1 and K2. They're designated for the family and kids area. So K1 is pretty large, and we can have families there and camping with their children. No. Well, then they have to camp somewhere else with their trailer. I'll get back to that in a bit.
If a question is asked,
Oh, yeah, sorry. I'll repeat the questions. So are there trailers allowed on the family village? No, there are no cars allowed on the grass itself. So there will be a part of the terrain, which you can see here next to the water. And we are kind of allowed to place campers there. It won't be a lot, so 20, 25 probably. We have to see how many there are, and they can be placed there. So K1 and K2 are the family village, and then if you go south, we have a silent lounge here. They were planning on having a fire pit, which I'm pointing out here. I hope you can see that. The problem is it won't be finished for SHA. Next to the lounge, though, there is a fireplace where you can make fire, so we have to do something there. The reason for that is that you can have open fire on the entire field, but we don't want to do that for security and safety reasons. Otherwise, everyone will make open fire, and for each open fire, we need safety measures, etc. So we want to have one dedicated place, like, okay, here you can have a fire and have fun. Well, the thing is that before you open the fire, you have to announce it to the fire department, and you need to have security present and to fire marshals. So technically, yes, we can do something, but my first answer will be no. And let's see if there's really a big request, and if then we might be able to handle it. But so the question was, if there's a village that does want to have open fire, is it impossible? Well, we can see if there are any possibilities. So down south, you see two track tents, the bar, a tarp, even more tarps. They're actually four next to each other, and food trucks around it. So that will basically be the main area of the event. Because there will be the track tents, and hopefully a lot of people will be there. Also, we have our Porto Cabin complex and info desk, and where people need to be for to get information, where we can ask for volunteers, etc. Because we want to have that in the center of the field. One of the things at OHM was that that you could sign up for to be a volunteer, but that was at the other end of the event where everything was taking place. And basically this entire area is designed for organizations. So we have a tent for the NOC, for audio, video, all the angels, and a kitchen tent, etc. So that is what is planned there. Now that that makes all these fields to the south, they are designed for the crew. So they are, they should be more silent, although we have to see how that works out. Yeah. So the question was, or the notification is that the crew fields aren't available in early build-up. I'll select this. So one of the things was on the last time, okay, we don't have enough build-up time. So what we arranged is that a part of the field we can access before the 31st of July. We can actually be there on the 26th of July already. But that means that we cannot really camp on the crew areas. There are a few tents allowed, but we think that at that time there won't be a lot of people yet. But we can find something. And in worst case, you have to move your tent. So that's but that's just for our organization. What the hexagon is? That's also a tarp. I requested quotes for tents and also for tarps, and they were not that expensive. So I said, like, okay, put in the middle of the organization terrain a tarp, so we can have a barbecue or something, or sit down outside, whatever we like.
Wherever, as long as you Stick with the dates. You can camp wherever. So there's no obligation.
No, you're not obligated to camp in the crew field, so of course. So if you look to the left, these fields are the main fields for camping, together with a field I here, and it should fit more than enough people. If we look at the numbers from the scouting, it should fit 7,000 people. Well, I think that we take more space than that, but we also have the areas next to the water. So in general, it would fit more than 5,000 people. And so there's another track tent here. We were looking at a mirror tent, but unfortunately they have been proven too expensive and also not very practical. One of the reasons is that it needs to be on a concrete floor. The problem is we have clay and that doesn't really go well together. And the other end is that the tent that we had in mind, you have to rent it for at least a month because the build-up time of the tent is just 8 days already. And the price is almost 100,000 euros. So that's another issue. It's very beautiful. another things that you see here on the three blocks, there are dedicated toilets and everything. One of the questions that we also got, are there for disabled people toilets? Well, that's one of our requirements with the scouting, that there will be toilets for disabled people and showers, etc., because we want people with a disability to feel welcome as well. I think that this is about the map and the layout. Are there any questions about that? Three, I don't know, but 32 by 40. But I'll get to I'll give you the tent sizes later. Yeah. Okay. Documentary. Elger.
So I didn't tell him. This is Barry, Geoman. Say hi, everybody. He's very new. And I didn't tell him this was in English, so
I had to prepare my speech in in a few minutes over there in English. So
give him some slack. The idea was Barry contacted me a few weeks ago, and he said I want to do a documentary on what we're doing here. And well, of course, the answer is yes. And we dived in on what is the possibilities, how this community works, that not everybody wants to be on film and such. And we've also seen on the mail, the documentaries by the CCC and such. And Barry has prepared a short speech to convince you that it's going to be absolutely fantastic.
Okay. Well, hello, my name is Barry. Thank you, Elger, for the introduction, and thank you, everybody, for your time. I'm going to start. Who am I? Well, my name is Barry. My passion lies within photography, and since a few years, videography also came along. And at the moment, I'm very passionate about both, and I'd like to combine stuff. And everything I do, I learned it by doing. And I taught everything myself. And that's why I need test cases to explore what problems I might encounter doing recording an interview, a live presentation, etc., etc. And that's the reason why I contacted Elger, because I really hate it when I do a test case and it serves no purpose. So I wanted to have someone that gives me the opportunity to try something and in the process try to create something that benefits the one that's given me the opportunity. So the project that I wanted to do was a documentary. I didn't really had a subject on what I wanted to record, but I wanted it to be something that interests me. And Elger, I've known him for
well, about 15 years or maybe more. And I know Elger does interesting things, and especially not especially things that are not ordinary. And I really like the quirky stuff. That's something that interests me. I don't know why, but it catches my interest. And the organization you try to run behind the big event, that's also something that came along in my past, because I was part of an organization that was hosting small parties where I live. And I noticed that a lot of people that visited those parties, they never knew how much time and effort it took to create that. And I see that here are a lot more people than in that small organization. So the frustration that people don't know how much time and effort everybody is putting into this, that it isn't seen, that was something that caught my attention. And I thought, I can use that to make a documentary about. One moment. The time frame. Because I like to do something that benefits the organization, and Elger also told me that a few things that promotion material and stuff, that's something that's always nice to have. So I thought, well, in the meantime that I'm working on the documentary, I can also do in a parallel planning, I can also make something that you can use in the meantime for all the small parts you're also organizing, and maybe for some other things. So that's one of the things I need your participation in, because I cannot do this without you. I need your input on how to fill in the documentary. My idea was to take a time frame from a year or year and a half, because I like to also display change. So this year in 2017, and then until 2018, so people can see from what you're doing this year, and in the meantime, when you're building up the event for 2018. You can reflect on what happened between 2017 and 2018. So people know how the organization changes, how it grows, what happens behind the scenes, etc., etc. What I also think is very important, that the people that are willing to participate in sitting in front of the camera telling about what they're doing, that I spend a lot of time with them talking about what would you like to show the world, what would you need, are there any things you might want to have that can be displayed on a video that you can use as promotional material, or the options are actually very, very large. That's broad. Yes, thank you. The options are very broad. So it's actually a big cooperation between me and every team that's doing things for this project. So I was in Dutch it sounded all better in my head than in English, so it's kind of hard for me to translate it at the spot. It's also a learning project. That's one of the things I need to tell you. It's for me, it's also about learning to do a bigger project, because in where I live near the German border, and the people who live there are they don't stimulate my creativity as much as when I come over here. So I really needed to find something that keeps me growing. And a bigger project like this, I've never done that before, so I'm also jumping into a black hole, not knowing what I will find. So I was hoping that you will also could learn me how to manage a bigger project like this, how to interact with people to get information about what they would like to see in the documentary, the things they might need for other small things they would like to have on video, or it's the options are again very broad, and I'd like to do that in cooperation with
everybody who would like to help me with creating this documentary. So it's a bit of a quirky story, but are there any questions about what I just told? I don't see any fingers yet. Oh, I see a question over there. Okay, the summary, okay. No. Okay, I will repeat the question. Because I said a lot of things here and you didn't expect this, I can write it down in an email so that my vision and it will be more clearer and that you can read it in your own time and then respond to that. Is that what you want? Okay. Is there are there any other questions about this? I see a question over there. Will the documentary be in English? In this case, yes, it will be in English. I didn't foresee this because Elger didn't told me that everything you do is in English. So that's something I just learned about 15 minutes ago. So it will all be in English. That's, for me, that's not a problem. It's actually a quite a fun challenge, actually. So thank you for the question, sir. So the last question. Could you repeat the last question?
Picture policy that everybody is.
Okay. Thanks. Okay. There are two questions. The first question is: will I be filming today? The answer is no. This was just an introduction to see if everybody was willing to let me do this. The second question is: how will it will go with the images that I shoot? Well. Everything. The answer to the second question is everything I do is in cooperation with you. If someone doesn't want to be on film, that's please tell me, then I won't put you on film. And in the end, all the raw material will be yours because I don't have any need for it, and maybe you can use it for someone who would like to make something out of it. So it's everything will be yours, sir. Okay. The remark was that that I don't just film people and then people have to approach me. I will always approach people first to ask do you want to be filmed, and I will always try to create a situation where my filming will not disturb your workflow in any way possible. So. By example, if I would have filmed today, then I would find a quiet space where I would ask someone, can I have a moment of your time to say something in front of the camera? Then that person would walk with me to a reserved space where nothing of your workflow will be noticed, or that you will find anything bothering about the recording itself. In the back. The question is. The question is: will the this approach miss the social interaction? The answer will be yes and no, because when I want to film something about the social interaction, then I will mention it to all the people over there. Is it okay that I film something? And it will always be in participation with everybody who's present, because I don't want anyone to feel strange that I'm there with a camera. So I will always try to respect everybody's privacy. And if the social interaction is shown, then it will be with people that are willing to be in frame. Sir.
The question is, didn't I start a year too early, or is too late? Sorry, or am I just interested in the financial aspects that happen after this year? The first question is, I don't know if I started a year too late, because the idea arose about a few months ago, so it's a very spontaneous idea. And the financial aspect, I don't really care. It's just that I want to make a documentary. I like filmmaking, and I want to show things that I really like, and not the financial aspect, because that's something that's none of everybody's business. That's your business, sir. Okay. The remark that was made is that the sir is mentioning that that nothing will much will be happening after this event, and Elger just told me that the event happens every 4 years. I didn't know that, so it's thank you for the tip that might shorten the period of the documentary, but the documentary itself. I think it's still a very nice idea to show what's happening until that part, and the financial aftermath. That's something that I will not be documenting. Maybe some other parts, but not that part. Yeah, I hear that my time is up. So thank you everybody for your time and the questions. So as the gentleman in the rear asked, I will. Put everything that I just mentioned and my vision about the project. I will put it in an email so that it will be distributed and you can read it about it in your own time. So, thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. Well, for the people who don't know, the CCC made a documentary over a period of 2 years before the CCC camp. Julia sent an email on the mailing list, because you can actually support her to get the CC license. So maybe you can see what happened there and what the result was of that, because it's pretty nice actually. Okay, the ticket shop. So we opened the ticket shop during the CC Congress, and we've been selling tickets after that. It's going pretty well. So as some of you have seen, we have several products in the shop. Obviously the entrance tickets are there in several versions. You can choose to pay more if you'd like to. There are also some business tickets, some with a ridiculously high price. Well, we hope to sell one, that would be nice. Either way, that is how it's going. So a question that we get is, how are the ticket sales going? Very good. It's not full screen. Okay. So the red line is that. Yeah, the red line says the maximum number of people that fit on the field. So right now with the ticket sales, which is the blue line, we're above that. So it's going very well, and either way, that doesn't mean that we have sold all the tickets yet, but we would like to sell tickets fast, and that mostly has the reasons for cash flow, because we have to pay things in advance. So I think that next month we will receive an invoice for the train, we will receive invoice for tents and other large materials that we have to order. So if you know people that haven't bought a ticket yet, but are able to buy a ticket, then please ask them to do so. One other thing that we will be doing is we will be giving out vouchers for the organization. So say that you are in the organization and you're going to volunteer, but you don't have the ability to buy a ticket right now. We will distribute vouchers that will be valid for the next few months, so that you can save for the event or somewhat have some more time to buy a ticket. We will also make some vouchers for hackerspaces and such, like the CCC has done for the CCC event. And we will also make them valid for a period, but a bit less than Orga tickets. But also that people from hackerspaces are guaranteed of a ticket and that they're not missing one. Yes. Do we expect to be sold out? Well, it was a useless graph, but right now, how the ticket sales are going, then yes, that would be the case. Well, the question is if I have if I can see into the future, and no, I can't. Yeah. So. Sure. So for the organization, we have made a reservation of so repeating the question, which I constantly forget, how many question tickets do we reserve for the organization? We override the maximum queue that we have, so there's not really a maximum. But I think that we've set that to 500 right now. That's separate from the hackerspaces. I'll generate separate vouchers for that. The idea is to give every hackerspace a voucher for 10 tickets. If you need more, then we can generate a new voucher. That's no problem. So that means that everyone who has a voucher code can buy one. One of the questions was... Oh, sorry. So what is the maximum amount of tickets that we can sell? We will apply a permit for 6,000 people, but that would be quite a lot. So we have made a budget for starting at 3,500 until 5,500, and we'll see where we end up. No. I can, but I won't. Okay, one of the questions that we got after the opening of the tickets is the parking. Where does the 42 euros come from? Well, Vincent will explain you that afterwards in a bit more detail. But the idea is that if we are not able to build a parking terrain of our own, we have to rely on commercial parking, which is on the other end of the river. So per car, that's 5 euros a day. And we have to transport everyone from that parking to the field. So it does have the cover the actual cost. Well, if we're able to build everything ourselves, and if that's much cheaper, then we can always see how we can return something, or we can see how we can handle that. But even building a parking terrain of our own, that involves quite some cost. But Vincent will go into that. Yeah, we're not getting a loan because we cancelled it. So the idea was that we would receive a loan to cover our cash flow, because one problem is that you have to pay some things very early. But we've made a deal with the terrain and both the tents. They are quite costly and you need to pay them in advance, but we can pay them later. So as I said, the terrain, we have to pay something February somewhere, and tents in April. But with the ticket sales that we've done, we can already cover those costs. So we don't need a loan. Although I did apply for the CC to get funding. We've asked them if they would want to fund so we can do additional things. We would like to do more with the family village. Maybe something like covering student tickets or something. That is the proposal that I sent out. And that is something that has to be discussed in the CC, and we hope that they can cover something for us. Now, one thing that might be boring, but on the CC, we got the question like, okay, how does your budget look like? And can I see it? And yes, we can. And I will post details later on the wiki, but I simply didn't have time to actually do that. in general, people want to know, are you making a lot of money on the event? Well, I can pretty much assure you that we don't. So what you see here is based on the number of visitors and the income that we expect to get. So the ticket sales, we're counting on a standard ticket sale of 250 euros. And you have to reduct the VAT for that. We'll probably get a lot back, but during the cash flow, we have to account that we don't have that full amount because we have to pay VAT already. So we expect to have some income from the bar. We hope that you will drink enough mate, etc., and some of merchandise as well. As you can see in the ticket shop, we have t-shirts and hoodies already, and they're selling pretty well actually, and there's not even a design or t-shirt brand or whatever, but I can say that we there have been quite some t-shirts sold. Sorry? Shut up and take my money, was it? Okay, thank you. That kind of things help on the event. With the parking place, we will get some income from that as well, but most of it is spent in the budget on making the actual parking places. From the food court, we expect to get some income as well, probably a percentage from the food trucks that will be there, but that won't be a lot of money. And some of this on the cardboard tents. So in total, you see that we have a budget ranging from 900,000 to 1.4 million euros. So it's not that we are organizing an event for 50,000 euros. There's actually quite a lot of money involved in this. Now, if we put that next to the expenses that we have, you see a red line. That means that it's not positive. Now, we... we do have an unforeseen part in our budget, and with that unforeseen part, we will would just make it into positive. So if you look at the budget for 3,500 people, we expect that we have 17,000 euros left. On a budget of 900,000, that's not a lot. So what we're working on right now, we've asked for some funding from the CC and from another foundation that has provided some funding in the past. And we hope that we can get some more room with that. Now, as the number of visitors increase, we also put more in the budget that teams can spend. So with 3,500 people, everything will be covered, but we can't do any special things. So for example, we have a badge, and which is really great. I'm not sure if they have any prototypes with them today. But you can have a look. And the thing is that the badge is really great and we can support part of it, but only if the if there are more people visiting, then we can make an investment bigger in the budget. And otherwise, everything has to be sponsored, all the chips and what they need. Okay, so what are a few of those expenses? For the organization itself, we need to hire some people, probably clean up after the event. Also, for example, the tents in the past, we always helped with volunteers with building them up. We found out that it generally doesn't work because we don't have the number of volunteers at the time that they actually need them. And the tent builders are basically busy, I think 12 hours a day because they start very early and we don't. Either way, that are some of the costs. Insurance costs, we have some travel expenses, booklets, flyers, etc. One of the large costs is team terrain. We obviously need to rent the terrain, sanitary. We will rent cleaning for the sanitary environment as well. So we don't have to do that ourselves. We have to pay for some water that we use, etc. We also have team infrastructure, including power, which I have to increase a bit. That are all the costs for the event. I can go over it in much more detail. Are there any questions on this that I can answer? Are there any things unclear? Because what I would like to prevent is that people think that we make a lot of money on the event, but we're certainly not a commercial event. Otherwise, we would probably be charging 2,000 euros for a day ticket. The question is, will we make it public? I will make parts of it because some of the values simply need an explanation. And you can't just put up values without the explanation that I'm currently giving. For example, some people might say, okay, why does the decoration need 5,000 euros? There are all kinds of reasons that need some explanation. So I will outline the well, the highlights. And I'll put that on the wiki somewhere in the next month. Okay. Well, the code of conduct. There was quite a discussion on the mailing list over that the past few weeks, or even before the before and after the CCC Congress. Basically, with OHM and all previous events, we didn't have a code of conduct. It was guidelines, and if there was an issue, that was always solved. And one thing that we want to make clear as an organization is that we want everyone to feel welcome and safe. So there shouldn't be a reason that you don't feel welcome or feel harassed. Or well, you can find numerous reasons that you don't like. So we want to set that clear on paper, and there has been a discussion like it couldn't be too specific, and it should be shorter, it shouldn't be too long, and it shouldn't cover the consequences. Either way, what we want to accomplish, we will add some things maybe to make it more fit some more people and some more opinions. The problem with the code of conduct is that it will never fit everyone, and it will never fit, make everyone happy. So unfortunately, Melinda couldn't be here today for personal reasons, but there will be a follow-up discussion on the mailing list to see what we can do, and that we make everyone happy with the code of conduct that is there. Are there any questions on this? Okay. Yeah. Okay, good. Oh, the remark was that we're very happy that we have a code of conduct. Okay, the call for papers. I don't have specific information, but the people from the content team are here. And what I've understood is that there have been much more submissions after the CC Congress. And it is progressing, although we will always need more submissions. So if you know someone, please approach it. If you need help, then try to contact the content team and find out. And okay, the team content has posted procedures on how ticket submissions work, and also templates to send emails and ask someone who wants to submit something. 3 days left, by the way. 1st of February. So we've made a lot of an entire list of orga meetings up until the event itself. It seemed, however, that a next meeting that was planned for the 5th of March that collided with Open Hackerspace Day. So we decided to move it a week forward, which makes it the 1st of April. So put that in your agenda. There's already a wiki page, so you can already sign up if you want to. And the location to be determined, but it might be a good reason to visit the terrain. We have to see if we can make that happen or not. Okay, so from the 1st of April, there will be an orga meeting every month. Obviously, it's not obligated to be here, but here or somewhere else. But we hope that we can have work meetings and that we can work on everything on a regular basis. Okay, you should just be here. If you don't agree, talk to Ruud. Okay, are there any general questions about the organization project lighting that we can answer, that we can help you with, etc.? Because after this, there will be two small presentations, one about the design and parking. So we will be here around from project lighting, and we can help every team with what they're doing and etc. Well, it would have been nice if it would have been in advance, but I'm sure that we can make some time about that.
What can you share about the stuff that's going not so good?
What I can share that isn't going so well. Well, one of the things is the counter on my inbox on email, and I think that holds for most of the project lighting people. Well, some of the things we wanted to have finished earlier, but we simply didn't get around to it. But in general, we're happy. What we, for example, like is some more people that help with organizing the events inside a few teams. For example, we have the parking team. They would like to have some additional people in arranging something. But also, sorry? Oh, okay, I'm killing his presentation. But that holds for a lot of teams. So what we have on the wiki is where you can see that people are still needed. And it's still it's mostly needed in advance. So that's one of the things. Okay. That's a long summarization. So on the wiki, you can find where we need people, and what we did with project lighting, we went over each team to see what the status is, what they're doing, and we basically assigned it a color: red, orange, or green. Most of them are orange or green, but we have a few teams that have some problems, four or five. One of them, for example, is the bar team, who doesn't have a team lead at the moment. Another one is food court and vendors, that was arranged by Mendel, but for personal reasons he decided not to help us with. So if you want to arrange things on the food court, for example, if you want to actually taste food somewhere, then that might be something for you. Exactly. So we have a vacancy page on the Orga wiki that you can look up and see where we need people. Okay. Yeah, so the question was if we can post the dates when the event build up and teardown is. That's actually on the Orga wiki now. If you log in and on the right side, it's the 26th of July till the 11th of August. Obviously, we don't want 500 people arriving on the 26th of July, but I'm sure that we can find our way. But if you need to request a time off from your work, that will be the most busiest period. Well, one of the questions that we get in ticket sales and from visitors is, when can I arrive? Now, that is something that we have to sit down with security, with project lighting, with the volunteers team, because we can't have 1,000 people in the weekend before, although we would like it. So you can't build up an entire house on the field. So we have to see, obviously we have day zero, and that's typically the build up day. And we have to see when can you arrive and how many people can we accommodate on the field. Also from security perspective, because permit-wise, we simply have to know how many people are there, what are the fire precautions or any other safety precautions that we have to take. But we will post that and guidelines and when you arrive. But we're still 8 months before the event. And well. Yeah, of course, I understand that you want to know when to take your holiday, but I hope that with this date you can take your holiday. Any other questions? No? Okay. Then next, design parking. I think that we should go to, with parking first, and then design and... that I killed half of your presentation, so it takes less. So, okay.
Okay, thank you. Well, the presentation is actually not about parking. It's about the team safety, which has parking in it, so I'll cover parking later. First thing, security. All the slides that have help wanted means we need people. So far, the sheet over there is the permit. Has to be filled in, it's still blank, because we have no one who wants to do it. The municipality will allow us to do our own security, if we can arrange it and make a plan. So far, we don't have anyone who wants to do it, or anyone who wants to be in a team. So the plan B is that we are going to hire people to do it for us. If you don't want that, please join my team. Then we have the parking and traffic team. Also there, we need someone who wants to do this, because now I'm doing it, and I'm doing like four sub-teams in my team, and I don't have the time to do that. So we need someone to do the team lead for that, and also angels who want to do a training to be traffic guiders. Then the parking part. Up here is going to be hopefully the main parking area, which can handle about 1,500 to 2,000 people, which is across the field. There will be a small orga parking down here for about 50 cars, which is where we parked in the field day down here. The yellow part down there. Yes. Yeah, down there. Yeah. It's a small parking area, so. Yeah, that's the emergency parking. Yeah, the yellow brick road. Okay, so the parking area is the blue area, light blue area up there, which is there if you zoom in. We're going to put like 1,500 plates over there so you can drive on it and the cars won't get stuck in the mud and sink away. And we will have to build a couple of bridges to do that to get on the field. The ticket prices for the parking are actually based on that we cannot do this. And the parking area will be over there, which is the green circle on the other side of the water, which is about 15 kilometers away, I think. Yeah, if we can't do the parking across the field, then we have to go down there, the green circle. Yeah, which is on the other side of the road, on the other side of the water. Yeah. Yep. Yeah, Team Harbor is gonna do the boat if we have to park there. You can take a boat across. So then the idea is that the roads, there's gonna be two entrance roads. One is gonna be coming from down and going up, and the other one is, that's why I need people to do the traffic, because we are gonna make a one-way road. And the municipality wants us to organize that so we don't cause any traffic jams and stuff like that. Which, in, if you look it up on the wiki, every information is there. Then the first aid team, we need people for that as well. If we can't find them, then plan B is to hire them, which is going to be expensive. And I think Breno has something to say about that.
Yes, we need first aiders. And I've said it before and I'll say it once more. We have got a very good offer to educate people to be a first aider. So you get a free training. The only thing is that we ask is that you run some shifts. And there are 12 people in a group. Currently 4 people have signed up already, so that's very good. It's going to be a 2-day training in Vinkeveen. And since I have a house there since yesterday, I'm going to throw in a barbecue for the people who sign up. So please sign up for first aid, because throwing it away to other companies is really a shame of throwing money away. Yeah, that's where it is. But Bill, you sign up by sending me an email, but it will be on the wiki. Yes, I did already twice, I believe, but I will do that once more. And one final time, and everybody who doesn't sign up will be shot. It's going to be a great training, absolutely the best.
I'm in a team that's is one of the exclusive teams, so I wondered if it makes sense if I would sign up for the first day. I will be walking around the terrain, so it could help somewhere, but...
You say you're already in an exclusive team. Well, if you're running around the terrain, and then it might be useful, but we have to look into every situation, because officially when you're on the first aid list, at that time you are not allowed to do other stuff because you need to be free to do first aid. But I don't expect everybody to fall over just yet, so we might work something out there actually. Yes.
So in general about that, we want to prevent every team here asking for help, because everyone here is already doing something. So that's why we had a page on the wiki, try to ask some people around you, but because 10 people asking here, no offense, that they need help, we won't get an answer here. So that was the reasoning.
The reason why we're asking now is because we can't wait because of the permit. We have 3 months left, yeah. This has to be in the permit.
One question over there, and then one there, and the other one is fake news. The dates, actually, we are totally free to determine that ourselves. So if you have got multiple groups, actually, but it will be probably a Saturday and a Sunday, or a Saturday and a Saturday, something like that, so that most people can join. And afterwards, barbecue.
What other qualifications can you bring? So if I already have a German qualification, will that work out?
Please let's discuss that afterwards, but that actually might help a lot, yes, because we are all Europeans. Europeans first.
Well, are we ready? But concerning first aiders and security, to have people, volunteers that are not interested in hacking and are not willing to pay for their ticket to come over and help. So I might be able to find people in the event.
So we've actually discussed it in Project Lighting. A friend of mine.
Yeah, why didn't you repeat that?
Yeah, it's annoying. More microphones in The question is, what about people that want to volunteer for specific things? Do they still need to buy a ticket? Well, that's actually something we discussed in Project Lighting, because you have very specific things like a doctor that probably doesn't want to pay for the ticket. Well, in those cases, we can make exceptions, but we have to see in on a case-by-case basis how we handle that.
Please talk to us about those.
Yeah, I only have one more slide, so. So then this is the last slide, and Brenna is going to do that one.
Yeah. There will be, of course, a great harbor. The thing is, we'll have a boat crossing the water to the hotel, and when we have the parking lot, there will be a boat that will pick people up from the parking lot and bring there. I won't ask for help, but I do need help. And the second thing is, we are looking into hiring boats. People that don't want to sleep in a tent could sleep in a boat, and there are nice big boats for that. If you're interested in that also, please, please contact us. And Attila's looking angry, so I think I'll leave it at that.
Design.
Yay.
Ja, maar hij pakt me nu wel. Colors. Ja.
Well, hello. I'm Jochem, a student from the Willem de Koning Academy in Rotterdam. Yeah, just a student. This will be the SHA design, and now we're going to talk a little about it. Yeah, we had a bit of requirements. It has to be hackable, creative, easy to create and generate, and colorful. Well, we started with SHA because we wanted to bring it close to the festival. Well, SHA is a secure hashing algorithm. Hexadecimal values for the characters. Can everybody see it? Good. Okay, perfect. Where's my mouse? And then we refer to the free speech flag. I think many of you guys know what a free speech flag is, and otherwise people can look it up on a wiki page. Oh, maybe I'll work on explain.
So there was some codes cracked, some I forget the exact thing, but there were some things that shouldn't be publicized, and if you would publicize them, you would get sued. So what you do is use the thing that you're not allowed to say and put it in songs and put it in all kinds of creative applications, such as a flag. So this is the I think the key for the copyright protection of the PlayStation 1, and that's put in a flag. And what we're doing is using the SHA algorithm, which also produces hexadecimal values, and convert those into colors, just like this free speech flag. And what that does, it's that's for you.
Okay. I have everything in the presentation, hopefully. Well, this will be, you can see the text. Well, it will be SHA 2017, because if you have the code. Yeah, can you see the mouse? Well, if you translate the SHA 2017, with the multiple spaces, then you get a code, and then you have it grouped, and then you can divide it in HTML colors. So that's why we chose those colors for design.
The question was, where do I get the 11,036 spaces between SHA and 2017? That's because we want to have the hash end on 2017. So we brute force that. We found a lot of places, especially with the uppercases, in the 10,000, 20,000, 30,000 range. If you would do it in lower cases, then you would go into the 100,000s and find something. You can see that in the source code of the thing that you will about to see.
Well, if you think I don't like these fucking colors, stupid designs with the crazy ideas, then we have a website already made by Elger and Claudia. So what the idea is, if we put in track one, then it will be those colors, but if you think, no, I don't really like those colors, then you make something else out of it. And then you have other colors, or maybe you get a space away, or maybe you think, oh no, I will do it with a lowercase k, then you can choose your own colors. So, yeah, it's very colorful, and you can be as creative as you want. Maybe even put an enter in it, and then put another one in it, or you can do whatever you want with it. So I hope you can do your own stuff. Yeah. Same as this one, I really don't like this color, so I changed the last F into more likable colors. The flyer, yeah, the flyer will, and this will be the flyer, the SHA color from the right side, that will be the back, and at the left side, yeah, you have the steel with the people can fill in their own thing in the middle, still studying, still whatever you like, still hacking anyway. That will be the main point. Then of course we have stickers and the signage. There we can And then you also see at the bottom right that you can make your own stuff out of it. Oh, we'll try and then we'll see. Well, then we also have some visual content, and this is just an example. Then you can in the color ranges. Then you can fill in your own pictures or pictures from speakers or videos or whatever you like.
Can this be automated? Yes, of course this can be automated.
Well, and then of course we have shirts. This will be if people like it, then this could be a shirt, and otherwise this is just a stupid example. Well, the website, well, you already seen something from it, but this will be this is just a mock-up. So, well, you can type in your own things you like, so like Claudia, or Still Hacking Anyway, or just SHA. And then we're going to make a save button, so people can make their own flags from their own camps or their own name or whatever they want to spread the message. Well, of course, ticket section, and we have a contact section. And I think.
Right, so can we standardize on a few things like SHA or SHA2017 with or without spaces? I know that's really important for people like us. yes, the thing with the colors is it makes it more flexible. How we are writing SHA now at the top of my head, I don't know. So we used it here to brute force the 2017 because it's funny, and I think we can determine something. As it stands now, it's SHA 2017 together without a space, so that's what it is. But also, do you also mean that the words that you can fill in on the blanks should be standardized? I don't think so. That's not funny. That's not funny. It should still what could possibly go wrong anyway. So it's all the question was it's all about the branding. So if you see a color set, then you understand this is SHA 2017, and that was exactly the point. You see, track one has its own signature. Track two has its own signature with different colors and the different code at the bottom for the bytes that we couldn't fit in the flag. So everything will have their own color code that they can choose, or that is just a given for every village. We can just generate them all at the same time. And they will also have a number, the four hexadecimal numbers. So everything will be recognizable like that. Like this. So everything is, once you set it, you can also independently verify that somebody is using their correct color because it's the SHA-1 algorithm. So if somebody is cheating, you can say, hey, you're doing it wrong. Or this, you don't understand what's going on. So you can build your own generator. If you have the SHA-1 hash of something, you just split it up into hexadecimal values and you got the color code. And we made a small example for this for the RevSpace to identify themselves. First question. Any questions? This is the hex value. Yes. So are the colors RGB? The answer to that question is yes. They are 0 to 255, or in hexadecimal in a byte. And how does that translate to Microsoft Paint? So Paint has a section where you can choose colors, and you can perfectly see what color you're picking. So to actual paint. So it would be, so how does it, in reality, if you would use a color meter, you would not be able to determine the original hash value. That would only be possible on computers. That's why the free speech flag is an interesting thing. And we made a small example of where you can see this terrible go wrong. But I need the generator here. It does. At the bottom here, if you look at the bottom, you see these are the colors that you get. So there are some discussions going on here. Are there any questions? All right, another question. please, can we have some attention? Yes, it's Roboto Black. No, there's not a logo. That was the question. We do have the stripes like this. Is there a logo? There's a logo. This is the logo. It will be stripes. It's based on that freedom, free speech flag idea. It's all right. We can always. Can I have please a little bit streamlining here? We can go into discussions about this and shapes or forms. I think that's the question. Are there shapes or forms associated with this thing? Currently, it's a rectangle with six stripes. The rest we can determine. Of course, we're going with this, but the rest, like how we connected, how we fit it into something that's more practical, we have to figure out as we go along. So we have to discuss afterwards.
We can discuss in it afterwards, but actually this the logo is this, right? That's the logo.
Right. This is the thing that you would see everywhere with the same color set and the same word in the same font.
And the same font.
The question is, can we make t-shirts like this? Technically, it's possible to print over the complete t-shirt, but we don't know. Yeah, we don't know if that's manageable or in individual print where everybody gets his own name in the hash. We don't know yet. But there is a shirt design, and feedback is welcome on that. So please, not all right now. So we made a small example to illustrate one of the questions that was asked. So if you put in RevSpace, like in the logo, you will get this one, and that's what we ordered. Yeah, this is the logo. Like if you have the logo, then this is what you get, and we made a small demonstration of what you could be using on the site. Is there somebody from RevSpace available here to take? I've got a thingy here. Don't be shy. You're going to reveal it? Okay. Oh, there's people coming on. Okay. Oh, here we go. Don't stab anyone.
So One wall we don't need to decorate anymore.
So the remark was one wall we don't need to decorate anymore. The font that's chosen has a lot of support for a lot of characters, so you can even make the famous Xia shrug face if you want. So. Sorry, repeat the question, please. Oh, we should drop the landing phase in the general. Can I?
Can I do something?
Yeah. What? Text. Smiley. This. And I copy. Yay! So yeah, you can enter your own Lenny face if you want for some reason. Here you go. Facts. Are you happy now? If you have any feedback, it's welcome. The source code is available of this tool, so you can write your own in I think 30 minutes that it took to take this make this one. Two questions. Okay, well, there's a the team badge only can support two colors, so lie to us then, please. There's full grayscale support, so we can transfer it. It's oh, there's now a live demo of the full grayscale support, so this will be perfectly translated to grayscale. Somebody could please brute force a grayscale color code. Another question. Are we publishing a style guide sometime soon? I hear yes here. So yes. All right, any other questions? No? Then we can all do some fun things. Everybody's here. I'm going to give the mic back to Attila.
The idea was to just work together, find some people that you need information from. There are a few new people here. Some new people for Power signed up. If you don't know who Timo is, he's in the back there. Go to him. There are a few people that wanted to speak to people from Project Lighting. Find each other. After that, at some point, we have a barbecue. Thank you. Have fun.